have you all tuned in on today's live show. We are, however, sponsored in part by one of our favorite sponsors, and I love these guys. If you enjoy fresh cupcakes, visit our wonderful sponsors today at Small Cakes at the Renton Landing. It's the yummy place on earth. That is Small Cakes at the Renton Landing, Renton, Washington. And can you say yum? Hey, I can say that, right? All right, folks, we have an incredible show today that we're going to be getting into. And as we do, I do want to encourage you to let your family, your friends, your neighbors know that we are on the air with today's live show. We're going to be joined today by Victor Tiffany. He is in the Bernie or Bust camp, and we're going to be visiting with him, and we're going to find out some more highlighted info and data on Bernie Sanders. Could he win the upcoming election? We'll see. We'll be right back.
Robert Christian Show. Addressing issues that matter. Interviews and subjects beyond traditional news. Visit us online at www.robertchristianshow.com. And now, your host, Robert Christian.
And thank you once again. All right, folks, as we begin today's live show, oh, Lord. Well, here we go. Bernie Sanders, he ran an unsuccessful bid for the office of the White House back in 2016. A lot of people do remember that. That's who's running for president, and again, now, and in 2020. A self-described democratic socialist and a progressive. Sanders is known for his opposition to economic inequality, which I do agree with. On domestic policy, he broadly supports labor rights, which I think any elected official should. He has supported universal and single-payer health care and paid parental leave. Tuition-free higher education are some of the points of massive interest. Now, in 1993, Sanders voted against the Brady Bill, which mandated federal background checks when buying guns and imposed a waiting period on firearm purchases in the United States. The bill passed by a vote of 238-187. Now, in 1994, Sanders voted in favor of the Violent Crimes Control Law and Enforcement Act. He said that he voted for the bill because it included Violence Against Women Act within it. And there also was a ban on certain assault weapons. Now, back in 1998, Sanders voted for a bill that would have increased the minimum sentencing for possession of a gun while committing a federal crime up to 10 years, including nonviolent crimes such as marijuana possession. Now, going into a fast forward mode, here we are in 2019. The key issue for Bernie Sanders and on his platform, they include healthcare for all, education for all, cancel all student loan debt, the right to secure a retirement, combat climate change, a firm commitment on our veterans, women's rights, disability rights, LGBTQ rights, gun safety, and criminal justice reform, just to name a few. Now, ladies and gentlemen, we are now joined with Victor Tiffany. Hello, Victor.
Hey, Robert. Thanks for having me.
Not a problem. I during the period where you, I guess you couldn't hear me for some reason, but I'm glad that you can hear me now. But I got everybody, I let everybody right up to the point of the most ultimate discussion about Bernie Sanders I think that I've ever had. So I can't wait. So how has your day been so far?
Great, pretty relaxing. I took the afternoon off from work and did a little promotional activity to let people know I'm going to be on the show. So I'm really looking forward to this.
Awesome. Well, let's dive right into it. And folks that are watching via the live stream, if you have a question that you would like to be answered by myself or by Victor, please type it in the chat box and we will get to as many questions as that we can. Victor, let's fast forward to 2020 if we can. The single platform that sends out is Medicare for All. What do you think of it?
Well, I think it's probably the most broad litmus test many Democrats have for a nominee for White House. I think it's going to be Joe Biden's downfall. He's criticizing it, running ads against it. And I think most Democrats by far want that, and it's a litmus test. So, of course, it's long overdue, and there's absolutely no reason we can't have it other than the fact that insurance companies are going to be put out of business. And of course, they're the ones who don't want this kind of social policy.
Well, you know, a lot of people, Victor, as you know, they say this is socialism now going in or taking over Medicare or the American health care. Well, they tend to forget what Medicare is. They tend to forget what Social Security is, what the national highway system is. You know, it all fits into the same thing, and it is socialized medicine, perhaps it is, but maybe that is exactly what America needs. What do you say?
Well, it is. There's so many people, even under Obamacare, when it was fully functional before Trump came along, there's still people who didn't have health care, couldn't get health care. It was better than what we had before, but not by a whole lot. And health costs can keep going up and up and up under this Obamacare system. We need a system that the government can regulate prices, control prices, and keep our costs down. These people who are saying, oh, I want my private health care insurance, I don't understand why. I pay a lot more, and Bernie makes this point over and over again. We pay a lot more now for health care coverage, just insurance, than we would if the government paid for it, because they don't have to run ads, they don't have to provide stockholders with profits, and any number of cost reductions that would be in place under a Medicare for All system. So, yeah, there's no reason why we shouldn't have it. In fact, long ago we should have had it, other than the fact that the corporations are in control of this country. That's why we need a revolution. That's why we're Bernie or bust. We need a revolution in this country. Sure, we want a woman in the White House. Sure, we want a gay mayor in the White House. There's a lot of things we want, but the fact of the matter is we need a revolution in order to get Medicare for All, in order to combat this climate collapse that we're on the verge of and may not have much time, may not have another 4 years to address. So this is not some sort of gimmick or optional strategy here. This is an absolute demand on Democrats. If Bernie Sanders is not the nominee, we're going to bail on the Democratic Party and find a third-party progressive candidate. In other words, it's Bernie or bust is equivalent to progressive or bust. We need these progressive policies for a variety of reasons, including health care for all, so that everybody in this country is covered and nobody dies unnecessarily.
Well, you know, I do agree with you, and I will mention this, that I did look up on Bernie Sanders' campaign's website today. And again, ladies and gentlemen, if you want to know about it, go to BernieSanders.com. You'll find this. Healthcare for all, free college education. That should be a right in America. The cancellation of student debt. I mean, you're looking at over $1 trillion in student debt alone. Jobs for all, the right to secure retirement, combat climate change. I mean, the list goes on and on. So he has a very big platform, Victor, wouldn't you say?
Well, he does, but so does Andrew Yang, for that matter. We've been on his site looking at his climate change policies. So the size of the platform is not the issue as much as what's on the platform, you know. You're putting up an interesting graphic. There was a Newsweek poll or a poll that was announced by Newsweek, presented in Newsweek, showing that Bernie Sanders is the most popular. He's not winning the polls right now, but in terms of just popularity, likability, Bernie Sanders is liked by, I believe, 72% of Democrats. And it's probable that the 28% who don't like Bernie Sanders somehow blame him for Hillary Clinton's defeat, even though he was out there, he endorsed her, he was out there campaigning for her. So there's an awful lot of hatred for Bernie that it looks like it's stemming from people who watch MSDNC, I mean NBC, because there's an awful lot of anti-Bernie, anti-Sanders propaganda popping up on that channel lately and really for quite a while now. He was safe. You know, when before he ran for president and challenged the establishment, he was safe to have on and nobody could needed to say a bad word about him. But now that he's actually challenging the grip on power that the neoliberal Democrats have in this country, either them or the neoliberal Republicans, now there's an awful lot of anti-Bernie sentiment out there. As you might recall from the program Up last weekend with David Gura, I believe his name is, the host. He had a Mimi Rocha on, and she was saying how, in a fact-free manner, how Bernie Sanders disgusts her. So, and then, you know, David said, well, we'll leave it there, right? So I've asked David, why don't you have me come on, and I'll provide the Bernie or bust perspective on things. And, of course, MSDNC will never have Bernie or bust on. They will never mention Bernie or bust. And we know this from last time. The first time the viewers of that channel heard that phrase was during the DNC 3 years and one night ago when Sarah Silverman blurted it out from the stage, you Bernie or busters are being ridiculous. That's the first time the viewers of that channel ever heard that phrase.
Yes, that's true. Well, I laugh about it because I remember it. I remember that as if it was yesterday, and I was like, you know what? What a great slogan. It really is. I mean, every campaign has a slogan. Well, I mean, yeah, Bernie or bust. But, you know, I tell you what, he was in Seattle, and he had an event at the Sporting Center downtown Seattle, and it made absolute national news when a bird landed on his podium and just sat there and started looking at him. I mean, even the bird was getting his message. That's what I got. It was absolutely undisputed the most hysterical thing that I've seen so far coming out of Bernie. But, you know, I do like Bernie. He has brought a lot of very interesting points of interest to the American landscape. And last election, now this is what made me mad. It really made me mad. Back in 2016, when the presidential election and all these campaigns were ongoing, well, MSNBC, as well as CNN, the kind folks at CNN, although I'm not on CNN, but here they were. They would much rather spend an hour and a half showing Donald Trump's podium with nobody behind it, nothing going on, than to air Bernie Sanders when he was live doing an event. And I mean, I thought, you know, what a catastrophe.
Well, they were instructed to do that, you know, Robert, by the Clinton campaign. The campaign instructed the media on how to cover the Pied Piper candidates, and they figured with, you know, get Donald Trump the nomination and they can beat him. And that kind of backfired on them. Yeah, 3 years ago today, we held the Bernie or Bust rally in Philadelphia, telling the superdelegates, nominate Sanders or lose in November. We had a billboard up to that effect between the airport and downtown. Nominate Sanders or lose in November. We had a press conference on the 25th, again, addressing the superdelegates. You can choose to unite the party and defeat Trump, or you will divide the party, because we're not on board with Hillary Clinton, and you will lose to Donald Trump. We made that very clear to them. They knew about our strategy. They knew we were not going to be on board, and they still chose the candidate. It was their job to pick the candidate who could defeat the Republican. And instead, they chose the candidate who the Republican, probably the only candidate in the country that Donald Trump could defeat, was Hillary Clinton. And that's who they decided to choose when they had somebody squeaky clean, virtually no baggage, who could have defeated Trump. It would have been, and still will be, a great contest between a Democratic socialist and a neo-fascist. So
let me dive into this with you, Victor. Knowing that Bernie Sanders, that he did run and ran a successful campaign, I will say that it was not successful. The last campaign that he ran, I think it very much was, at least, you know. And I look at success by the value of the message that was broadcast, that was gotten out there in the public. But here's my question to you, Victor. With the Bernie or Bust campaign, you saw how it went the last go, and here we are now, 4 years later, or three years and some odd days after that. But your group, are they regrouping from where they originally were, or are they looking at what's going on now and saying, you know what, now comes the time for this new revolution and new change taking place in America?
The latter, I think. We're in a much stronger position compared to where we were 4 years ago. We had 4 years ago one Burn Your Bus narrative on our homepage, a pledge, and a Facebook page. And that was it. Now we have a bumper sticker that says Burn Your Bus. We have a book that we're using to explain to people, Democrats particularly, why we need a revolution in this country. And that was under President Obama. People are nostalgic for Obama, but they forget just how much we were sliding into fascism under Obama. Of course, now we're accelerating into fascism. But this is a polemic on neoliberalism. And we think most Democrats, particularly people who support Joe Biden, just don't understand how much this political ideology is taking this country down the tubes. The Trans-Pacific Partnership, which is a transnational corporation's wet dream, in fact, they crafted it, would have converted our entire system of government, federal, state, and local governments, from a democratic system of democratic self-government set up by the framers of the Constitution into a system of corporate self-government. This is coming from Obama. So we're in a much better position now. We have an integrated strategy that a wide variety of Bernie or Bust narratives extort or be extorted, right? Bernie or Bust is a form of extortion. We're telling the Democrats, if they don't get behind Bernie, Trump's going to get elected. Right, that's a form of legalized extortion. But if Joe Biden or Kamala Harris or any one of these neoliberals wins the nomination, they're going to use the same extortion on us. They're going to say, look, you've got to get behind our candidate. You may not be real fond of our neoliberal or our establishment or our centrist candidate, but if you don't vote for him or her, we're going to get Donald Trump again. It's the same extortion, except in Bernie or Bust, we're applying it during the primaries, and the way they will apply it is for the general election. But it's the same extortion. So we have the book, the bumper sticker, a whole range of narratives that describe, like I said, extort or be extorted. Bernie or Bust is a declaration of war on the establishment. A whole range of these narratives left over from last time. Plus, we come into this with nearly 47,000, we have over 48,000 Bernie or Busters at this point. That is subscribers to our newsletter. Where were we 4 years ago at this point? Maybe 1,500 subscribers, 1,500 people who had taken that pledge. Mm-hmm. So we are way ahead. We are certain that Bernie or Bust is a foregone conclusion. Because and therefore that means the only candidate running as a Democrat this time around who can defeat Donald Trump is Bernie Sanders. And Bernie or Bust is only one of four reasons why.
Well, I think that Bernie, you know, again, he brought 3 years ago, he brought some very vital truths that I think that people needed to hear, and I think he still does. But then comes the ageless question, which is number two on the list that I had run off to you earlier, that we need to question. And I think it is only appropriate, it's only right for every American, if you like Bernie or if you don't, if you support him or if you don't, we need to ask the question not just to Bernie or about him, but to every other person who is running about their electability. Is he electable to the highest office in the land, A, knowing how old he is, B, knowing the platform that he stands on, that it is progressive, it's extreme in some cases, but is that the platform that is better suited for the campaign trail or for the White House? What do you think, Victor?
For the White House, if you look at the polling of basically all of his policy positions, it's almost as if he went and polled, did some polling before he took these positions. All of these have 50% or more support. Every one of his policy positions have broad support. Even the Green New Deal has broad support among the electorate. So based on policy positions, he's running as a populist. Based on that alone, he can run. He'll get the center more than Donald Trump will because his policies are more popular. But going back to why he's more electable than any of these centrists that are out there, Bernie or Buster's aren't going to support a centrist. There are 50% more people based on 26 polling after 2016. There are 50% more people who Bernie supporters who voted for Trump than who were Bernie or bust. The Bernie or Trumpers are not Bernie or bust. There's no organization behind that strategy. There's no pledge behind that strategy. They just did it. I don't know if it was out of revenge or out of disdain for Hillary Clinton. Whatever it was, there's a lot more Bernie or Trumpers than there are Bernie or busters. So that's a second problem. These people aren't going to vote for another centrist. So there's Bernie or busters, there's Bernie or Trumpers. And then And polling I've seen recently reported by Politico supports these other two categories. Thomas Piketty had an essay published in 2018 based on data from 70 years of voting in the United States, England, and France, showing that unless there's a candidate like Bernie Sanders, a democratic socialist or a social democrat, on the ballot, millions of poor people and poorly educated or undereducated people stay home. That's why Hillary Clinton lost. It's not because she was beaten by Trump, it's because she didn't have support, which amounts to the same thing. But Democrats stayed home. Hillary Clinton offered them nothing. Donald Trump offered them nothing. A lot of poor people stayed home, and that's the way it's going to be this time around. Bernie, on the other hand, is the Democratic Socialist. He's offering these populist policies. Poor people need health care, right? They can't afford it. They want his health care. They want to send their children off to college, right? He's going to offer them that capability. And $15 minimum wage. That's going to come from President Bernie Sanders pushing Congress. So his policies are very popular with poor people. And he's the only candidate. He's not the most funded, well-funded candidate, but he's the only candidate with 1 million volunteers signed up to help people. So these are the people who are going to go out, get the poor people and the poorly educated people registered to vote, and on election day they will go to their homes. If I were Bernie's campaign manager, this is what would be getting organized. These volunteers can go out to people's homes, pick them up, transport them to the polling places, make sure they vote, and take them home again. So he's got the army to mobilize these two major sectors of voters who will just stay home on November 3rd, 2020, while Donald Trump gets elected again, reelected.
So I question, though.
That's what makes him more electable than any other Democrat running.
I question his electability for one big reason. and that is his age. Yes, he can speak to America. He can speak their language. He understands the heartbeat of America. He's in touch with it. Whereas I don't believe that Donald Trump ever has been. However, I think that Bernie, his platform, it is very fresh. The problem is, again, for a lot of voters, potential voters, for him, it would be his age. They're like, oh, he's, you know, I'd vote for him, but he's too old of a man. And I'm like, wait a second. Right now, today, I wouldn't vote for any of them. Because right now, I want to know, including Bernie, and I love Bernie to bits. But my personal thing is that right now, it is way too early to say, you know what, I'm going to vote no matter what for this candidate. I'm going to all in, just absolutely all in. You know, I'm like, wait a second. No, I'm not going to be all in just yet. I want to know, A, what their platform is. B, how are they resonating with the voters in America? How are they resonating with the heartbeat of America? What platform, the planks of their platform, because those are the things that it's going to ultimately carry him through and carry him on. So is he electable? I would say I don't know. I don't know. There's a lot, and I say I don't know because, I mean, look, we're what, a year out? From a year and a half out from the election. So right now, do you think it's a bit premature to say that somebody would be electable or would not be?
No, I at risk of being critical of your analysis, I think that you're expressing ageism. Bernie, I think, would beat me in a foot race. I do. I've seen him go through airports.
Maybe so.
And he's probably would beat me in a game of one-on-one basketball. So for a man his age, he's in great shape. He's in far better shape than the incumbent. I just don't see age as being a problem. And if it is a problem, if it's going to be construed as a problem, I think that's going to be addressed by his running mate, because if there is something that happens, he has a stroke or a heart attack or whatever, you know, who's he going to have that will fill in and take his place? That's going to be a critical factor in how electable he is. But he's not much older than Donald Trump. I mean, you're making it sound like we've got a young man in the White House versus a geriatric competing against him, and they're
no,
both.
Victor, I love it. I absolutely love you for what you just said, because that's exactly it. Exactly and precisely, because people look at candidates and say, oh, he's too young. Well, we can't have that guy because he's African-American. He can't do anything in the White House. We can't have her because she is a woman. No matter what the access baggage is around any of these candidates, we can't have her because she's a woman. We can't have him because he's African-American. We can't have him because he's a rich billionaire that lies to America. Okay, I mean, come on. And then here's Bernie. Well, we can't have him because he's too old. So, I mean, if you look at what everybody is saying, we can't have, then I wonder, then who can we have? You know, America, we can't have a gay president. Well, we had our very first billionaire president, billionaire in the White House. I'll say that. I've never called him president. So kind of mark that out. But, you know, we have had, America is a nation of first. And maybe, again, Bernie is striking the match that is going to light this thing on fire and get people behind him, supporting him, no matter how old he is, no matter how young he is, or no matter how progressive his platform plank actually is. What do you think?
Yeah, I just don't think age is as much of a factor as people are making it out to be. He's if you listen to him speak, he's not slurring his words like Joe Biden does on fairly frequent occasion. Mm-hmm. He's keeping up a very hectic pace. I mean, I couldn't do what he's doing just because I don't have the kind of stamina he seems to have. He's in extraordinary shape for any age. So I just think that age is an excuse that's being put up by his detractors for, as you know, like, oh, he's just too old. But the problem is, who would be better than him? There is another candidate out there that running as a Democrat that we have in position as Plan B. What if Bernie has a heart attack? What if Bernie has an accident? What if Bernie has to drop out for any reason? 4 years ago, we would have been dead in the water. We had no Plan B. This time around, we do, and the reason we do is because we had to figure out how to include another very progressive candidate in a strategy that is inherently exclusive. Bernie or bust, right? No one else, just Bernie or bust. So how do we include a second very progressive candidate in that kind of strategy? This was one of the very few continued pioneering characteristics of Bernie or bust 2.0. First time, it was all pioneering. We were figuring out how to do this every stretch of the way. We didn't know how to promote this. We didn't know what we were doing. We literally didn't know what we were doing. And that's another factor behind Bernie or bust this time around. We know what we're doing this time. But the one pioneering characteristic of Bernie or bust 2.0 is how to include Tulsi Gabbard, a very progressive candidate. She doesn't define herself as a democratic socialist because she eschews these kind of labels, which is actually a benefit when you're competing against an anti-socialist right-winger like Donald Trump. So basically, what I'm trying to say is if Bernie has to drop out for any reason, we seamlessly slip from Bernie or bust right over into Tulsi or trash the Democratic Party. And one thing this does is it gives Bernie kind of insurance so that he's not taken out through whatever means by the establishment. If he starts to win and the establishment says, well, we can't have Bernie Sanders, let's assassinate him, let's make sure he's too sick to run, is still not going to help them because we're just going to slip right into Tulsi or trash the Democratic Party. So we think we have a very, I mean, this is actually a benefit this time around that we can actually bring to the mix and help Bernie, at least in this regard. And a lot of people want Bernie to select Tulsi as a running mate. But I think he's going to have to pick somebody like every presidential candidate does that to round out his appeal. Probably someone either from the South or someone from the West. Of course, you can't get any further west than Hawaii, but
right.
We'll see. That'll be an interesting pick if it comes to that.
All right, well, hang on for me, if you will, Victor. Ladies and gentlemen, this is the Robert Christian Show, live from Seattle. And our featured guest, Victor Tiffany, is on. And we have been enjoying a good roundtable discussion about Bernie or bust. Does Bernie Sanders have what it takes to win the upcoming presidential election or not? Folks, we'll be right back with more of the Robert Christian Show right after this. With your kind donation to the Robert Christian Show, it will help us to reach our goals in providing content that you love. This program is made possible by people just like you. Interactive newsmakers and interviews. Your progressive voice with interaction. The Robert Christian Show. Thank you for your support. And we are back, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you, Maestro. And thank you all, our guests, our fans of the show, our friends. We want to thank you all as well for tuning in for today's live show. We are joined, ladies and gentlemen, here we are in part number two, or the second half of our interview with Victor Tiffany, We are honored and happy to have you back on with us, Victor, after such a short little break.
It's great to be with you.
So let's get into the third point, and it's going to be go a little bit faster, I guess, from here on to the top of the hour. But we, when it comes to Bernie Sanders, that we should also question his leadership skills. Will he divide America any worse than it already is? Is that even possible? Or will he unite America? Victor, you take it away.
Yeah, both. I mean, that sounds strange, but he is a uniter. He talks about uniting people all the time. He denounces Trump for dividing people all the time. But anybody who has an ideology, and he does, it's progressive, is going to turn off people who don't like that ideology. Right? There are conservatives in Vermont who vote for Bernie Sanders. He wins people over by his style, by his leadership capabilities, by his, not even necessarily by his policies. Conservatives might not like everything he cast a vote for in the Senate or the House when he was in there, but they like his style, they like his honesty, they like his forthright manner. So he's going to be able to unite more than the current occupant of the White House, but no one can truly unite a country that is ideologically divided the way modern societies are. It's not just the United States. And this is becoming even more so the case with the internet, right? Because this is a progressive program and there's conservative programs, right? So people are breaking up into camps and reinforcing their beliefs by listening to programs that does just that. So it's going to be both. He's going to unite in ways that Trump doesn't even try. But being a democratic socialist is going to absolutely freak out the people at Fox News, for example, right? And Rush Limbaugh, and yeah, the whole right-wing echo chamber. So yeah, he can't unite everybody. It's just a chimera to believe otherwise. But he will certainly be as uniting as he possibly can. And I think, you didn't ask this question, but I think an important concern is the 2022 elections. He's going to be able to use the bully pulpit and get around and follow up or continue the political revolution that if he's elected only begins, right? Until he has a progressive Congress who will enact his populist agenda, he's still not going to get much done. But as president, he can be far more influential in that regard than he can as just a candidate. But I think he also will have coattails. When he's bringing out these poor people, they're probably going to vote blue this time around, assuming he's the nominee. When he brings out the poorly educated people, they will vote blue. So he'll have coattails like no other candidate that's currently running.
Well,
Harris will have coattails, but different coattails. Right? She'll have more women supporting her. Bernie will have more poor people and more poorly educated people. And of course, all the Bernier Trumpers and the Bernier Busters. So he's going to have very long coattails, and I think the political revolution is actually going to take two or three election cycles to really complete. And that's when we can really start addressing climate change in a truly aggressive manner that only a progressive has the political philosophy in which to do. Like FDR, he'll mobilize the government against a common enemy, not Russia, not China, not the terrorists, but the fossil fuel industry that's taken this whole earth rapidly toward mass extinctions, including the human race, if we don't get a handle on not just climate change, but the use of pesticides, which is wiping out the flying insects. And once they're gone, it's going to destroy the food chain, and we're going to see just maybe not complete extinction, but something very, very close to it. It'll be dangerous, rugged, brutal, nasty, and life will become very short.
Well, you know, speaking of Joe Biden, Victor, speaking of Joe Biden, he brought up on one of his platform speeches, which I thought was genuine. I thought it was great. And he spoke a truth, and that is this, that this upcoming president that takes the oath of office and sits in the Oval Office, that president, whoever that is, they are going to have to face the issue of climate change once and for all, and either dispute the facts as that they are, as if they don't exist. Well, we already have that going on. Or say, yes, we've got to do something about climate change, because otherwise, look at what's going on. But you know what? Bernie Sanders is also about climate change. He gets this. He understands us.
Right. He had a sort of a town hall meeting with Bill McKibben and a few other people a while back on this subject matter, including a Republican mayor from, I believe, Louisiana, which, like Mayor Sanders, back when he was mayor of Burlington, Vermont, that mayor, I can't remember his name now, in Louisiana, made his city carbon free, carbon neutral, right? With converting, getting things switched over to renewable energy and so forth. So the thing about Biden, the problem with Biden, first of all, he doesn't endorse the Green New Deal. Bernie does. And I just don't trust Biden. His record on this is not very good. He's coming from Obama administration. And remember, Obama's approach was all the above. We can't afford that this time around. So the idea that Biden says something that sounds good needs to be taken with a huge grain of salt. Candidates running for office will say anything to get elected. And I think a lot of them lie. So it's important to separate what they say, what comes out of their mouth, to compare to what they've done in the past. And that's what separates Bernie Sanders from Joe Biden, like the Grand Canyon. Right? Because Biden was part of an administration, and he's got a horrible record in Congress on a wide variety of issues.
Well, that brings us
and
right...
And that's what he's done. That's his record. So forget what Joe Biden is saying. He'll say anything to get elected like any other politician.
Yes.
Look at what they've done. Forget what they say. Concentrate on what they do and what they've done.
Well, Victor, that is a perfect jump-off point for the final part of the list that I had shared with you before. And this is, again, I'll read this, folks, and let you all know so you'll know. Because there were four major issues that I wanted to discuss on today's live show. And one of them is this. Last, that we should look at Bernie Sanders, his track record of voting, to give a better idea as to how liberal he is, how progressive he is, how Democrat he is per his votes. Now, I want to also say, you know, for me, it is not a matter of how liberal Bernie may be or how progressive he may be. Let's get rid of the label. It's time for people to get rid of this. And it's time to look at him, like any other candidate, as who that they are. If they are more liberal-minded, if they are more progressive-leaning, perhaps than what we have in the White House, I mean, everybody else, even the Republicans that would be running against Donald Trump, would be a bit more progressive, I think, than who we have in the White House today.
Unless it's the Texan Senator Ted Cruz. I think he's actually to Trump's right.
And, you know, Ted Cruz, you know, I would, trust me, I would eat him up on a live show. You know, because, look, I look at it this way. The fans of the show, those that listen to the podcast, I love them. But they deserve to know the truth. And sometime to get to the core of that truth, I have to go and ask the hard questions that nobody else wants to ask. And I guess I'm just gullible enough to do it. So, but going into the fourth part of the show, looking at Bernie's track record. Now, what do you think about this? That Bernie Sanders voted against the resolutions authorizing the use of force in Iraq in 1991 and in 2002. And he opposed the 2003 invasion of Iraq. He voted for, in 2011, the authorization to use military forces against terrorists. He has also been cited as a legal justification for controversial military actions since the September 11th attacks on America. Do you think that he's up for the job?
I do. I think there's a lot of mistakes that have been made in foreign policy since the attacks of 9/11. I think there weren't an awful lot of things I agreed with who ran against Bush in 2004, Kerry. Kerry in 2004 was arguing against the war on terrorism, that it raises these criminals, these terrorists, to a level that we shouldn't have ever done. So, and he argued that we should approach this as a criminal manner. And I think Bernie Sanders would be doing something along the same lines. We need a genuine national defense against terrorists. But let's be real about that. Far more terrorism in the United States is coming from right-wing terrorists than it is from Islamic fundamentalists. All right, so it's the whole idea of waging a war on a methodology is kind of silly. There's no question that he's against regime change wars. And if you look at his track record, there's people like Kathy Griffin, I think it just was, you know, what has he passed? I think, no, it was someone else on MSNBC, Mimi Rika. You know, what bills has he gotten through Congress? He's the amendment king, right? He's gotten an awful lot done in Congress, not necessarily shepherding a bill through Congress, but getting amendments to bills and improving bills and changing bills. So I don't think he's going to be a conventional president in terms of, you know, the United States since early 20th century has been an empire. It doesn't get discussed much. It doesn't get framed that way. You're not even going to hear Tulsi Gabbard talk about the American empire. But this was actually on the ballot in 1900. Should we have an empire or should we have a republic? And the people voted for empire. And so that we had basically attacked the Philippine Islands. We had concentration camps in the Philippines. People, you know, attack Ocasio-Cortez for calling the camps down the border concentration camps. They're just concentration of people. And we did it during World War II with American Japanese. The point is, I don't think he's going to govern like an emperor. I think he has to be, and we argued this in 2016, I don't think he can run as a pacifist because Trump would beat him that way. I think he has to, I think this whole business of foreign policy, it's like walking through a minefield. He has to be very careful with every word he speaks and where he comes down. And I don't think he can take advice on this. I think he knows best on how to get across that minefield. Better than taking advice from, say, Code Pink. I love Code Pink. I love those people. But if he runs as a pacifist, he's not going to get elected. On the other hand, I don't think he's going to govern as an emperor the way every president since World War II has governed. I don't think he's going to do wars of intervention. He's not going to do regime change wars. And how he fights the terrorists, you know, maybe this will come out in polls, but I think he has full capabilities of being commander-in-chief, addressing a rising China in a way that needs to be done. I think some of the things Trump does is actually not all bad. We are in a war with China now. It's kind of a cold war. It's mostly done online. And, of course, you've got Trump using tariffs to get them to stop doing certain things like manipulating their currency and so forth. Not everything Trump done has been bad, right? Some of the things he's done has actually been good. first thing he did in office was shred the Trans-Pacific Partnership. That was probably the best thing he's done so far. And challenging China, a rising China, in a way that curbs their aggression or their rise of power, I think is not stupid.
Well, but, let's fast forward here just a few minutes. Victor, let's fast forward here just a couple of minutes because we are running out of time for the show. As it is, folks, we've covered an awful lot in this show, and Victor, he's very knowledgeable with, I believe, with what his personal ideas are, his stance on things, but also the Bernie or Bust movement. He understands this, but one thing that I do want to bring in the last 5 minutes, Victor, if we can spend about 5 minutes perhaps on it, then hey, we can call it a day then. Back in 1999, Bernie Sanders, he voted and he advocated against rolling back the Glass-Steagall legislation. The provisions that kept the investment banks and commercial banks as separate entities. He was also a very vocal critic of Federal Reserve Chair Alan Greenspan. So bringing that in, Victor, in about 5 minutes' time, what do you think that Bernie Sanders could do to the economy or for the economy in the United States?
One of the most bizarre endorsements Bernie got last time he ran came from Rand Paul, libertarian Rand Paul, who argued that Bernie's policies were more market-oriented than all the other candidates, Republican and Democrat. I thought that was pretty insightful. Bernie's socialism is not anti-capitalist, right? It's anti-neoliberal. He's against this trend toward privatization of everything, obviously. But in terms of how he's going to approach the overall economy, I think his biggest problem is going to be an exit of capital. I think there's a lot of people are going to go, oh my God, a socialist in the White House, and they're going to leave, right? They'll just transfer to Mexico, they'll pick up their headquarters and go to Ireland where corporate taxes are very low. So I think there's going to be a problem in some economic stability that Bernie has the governing philosophy to counter using government programs and government spending and government mobilization. So I don't think he's going to be as transformative as, say, a Marxist would be. I don't think a Marxist is going to get elected. But I think he's going to sort of get us back toward in the direction of the New Deal. And more, he's really about more freedom for everybody. This is something I think he'll offer as a counterpoint to Trump's propaganda. Oh, he's a socialist. The right to health care, the right to food, the right to shelter, the right to potable water, and clean potable water in states like in Michigan, like in Flint, Michigan. These are all rights that increase human liberty. Bernie's democratic socialism will lift us all, not just the rich people. And I think this is why you see him being attacked by the elites, particularly on MSDNC, because we're all going to be free and from poverty, free and from want, and free from need, rather than just having the elites having these kind of privileges. And I think that terrorizes them. This isn't a zero-sum game. We can all benefit from democratic socialism and a greater democratic order. So I think the biggest change you're going to see from Bernie might be in trade, right? I've seen him categorized by the Peterson Institute, of all people, as against trade. And that's a smear, actually. He's not against trade, he's against free trade, and he's for fair trade. So you're going to have you know, poor people protected better in trade agreements, American workers protected better in Sanders' negotiated trade agreements, and maybe he'll actually follow the Commerce Clause of the Constitution and put trade back into the hands of Congress. Congress regulates commerce with other nations, and I don't know why the executive branch has a trade representative. That's not in the least bit constitutional. But again, I'm not advising Bernie Sanders. I'm just an activist out here, independent from the campaign, working to basically use this pioneering, unprecedented strategy of telling an entire major party, if you want to defeat the Republican, here's the candidate you have to get behind. And if I could just add, people who want to get their hands on a bumper sticker, get their hands on our how-to guide for peaceful revolution, or take the Burn Your Bus pledge, they can go to burnyourbus.info, I-N-F-O, and all three of those are available there. And we can, using leverage, electoral leverage, telling the Democrats, you want to defeat Donald Trump, you have to nominate Bernie Sanders. You have to see, he's the only one who can unite the party. And no doubt there are one percenters, people who are on MSNBC, people who are funding Joe Biden's campaign. They're going to vote for Donald Trump, right? They prefer to have a corporation in the White House. And Trump is a corporation. He's Trump Incorporated. So he's not going to completely unite the Democratic Party, but more so than any other candidate possibly can, if only because of Bernie or Bust, but also because of the other three categories of voters I've previously outlined. Does that answer your question?
Yeah, it does, Victor. It does. Hey, hang on for me if you will, Victor. Hang on just a second. I'll be right back with you, Victor. So hang on. Folks, this has been, and this is, the Robert Christian Show live from Washington. Hey, it is a pleasure, of course, to have you on the live show and tuned in and paying attention. Folks, this is our ultimate democracy. And we have the choice today of either looking forward and persevering for America's future, installing people into leadership positions and offices that can lead, and lead uprightly, lead honestly, and do a right thing and a good thing for America, or not. The choice, ultimately, is ours. Folks, I'm Robert Christian. You can visit us on the web at robertchristianshow.com. And hey, there's my hat and microphone. One of these days, folks, I'm going to put my hat on the auction block and actually auction it off. Hey, I've been asked to do that, and I just might, if anybody wanted to know. But anyway, visit us on the web at robertchristianshow.com. And don't forget last week's show. If you have not seen last week's show, please do give that a visit, because I gave my prediction for the upcoming presidential election, and you may or may not agree with that, but at least it will get you talking. Folks, I'm Robert Christian, and we'll catch